Man, I could talk a long time. It's kind of a spinoff today because I'm going to talk about full life and gratitude-filled living, being grateful. But man, the theology of God's goodness, it's not cheap grace or easy believism. That's who God is. I have listened to at least three podcasts this week / reading of Robbie Zacharias. Has anybody ever heard of Robbie Zacharias? And he's brilliant. He's a Christian apologist who's a Christian. I mean, dynamic, gentle in spirit, but so direct. And he said that in different settings, they asked him, they said, what is the biggest struggle that you see when you're on college campuses, universities, and all the places you go to defend the faith? And he said, oh, this. People say, Robbie, how can a God who is all-knowing, all-powerful, and all-loving allow pain and suffering in this world? That's nothing new. People think now they've got this brilliant argument. That's the age-old argument. That's what people have always wrestled with. But it comes down to a matter of faith for us when we decide ahead of time that God is good because he said he is. If you wait and go circumstantial, here's how it looks. I say this to people a lot, and this seems harsh, but I want you to think about it. So God is so good. Man, I want to tell you God's so good, and you're going through a hard time, Joel, and I just want to tell you God's good, God's good, God's good. But when the same thing happens to me that happened to you, I'm not so sure God is good anymore. What's that say about my theology? That's shaky, in the weeds theology. And that is the essence. In fact, I believe that is the essence of holiness. That's about a life of surrender beyond salvation, not just giving him our sin, but giving him ourselves. It is fully embracing his goodness and saying, you truly are good all the time, and I am never going to go back on that. I've decided ahead of time. And so I'm going to look for your goodness. I'm going to look for your activity. I'm going to look for you working in the middle of where I am, because our relationship with him isn't about the past or the future. Those take care of themselves. It's about right now. Your relationship with God the Father is only as good as it is right now. Relationships are a now thing. So I probably need to talk more about that. But if we decide that, we're going to begin to live fuller lives, because our hearts and lives, if we truly have settled the issue, have you settled the issue of God's goodness? Come on. It's trendy to be mad at God. He can handle it better than I can. I get ticked sometimes at people that are mad at God and think, who are we to get mad at him? But he can handle it. God can handle it. But we've got to settle the issue of God's goodness. And then as we do that, we're going to be stepping out into a new dimension of gratitude-filled living. That means we are grateful. We find reasons to be grateful. We have an attitude of gratitude in every situation, and it's not trumped up. It's not fake. It's not false, because we know we've settled that issue. I want to ask you again, have you truly settled that issue in your heart? That is so basic to truly being a transformed, changed believer, living transformed. God is good, and my heart is filled with gratitude. I often go to lists in the Bible to describe the times, and you know, I look at Romans 1, like verse 17 and on, and I look at 2 Timothy 3, and isn't it interesting, as you look at all the horrible things that are going on in the world now, you know, I tell you that in both those lists, you know, all these New Testament words, whoremongers and all these defilers and all that, and when I was a youth pastor, I'd get down to one and it said, disobedient to your parents, and then I'd stop for about 3 minutes and just look at them. And right in the middle of the list, in both, but especially in 2 Timothy 3, you know what it says? Among all these horrible things that people do that separates from God, ungrateful. Start the timer. I'm going to look at him for 3 minutes. Would you begin to squirm? Don't you think that if you're truly grateful, it's going to show? So we're going to look at the story of the leper here in a little bit. And I love this. I think I ended with it, but around our house, we have watched movies at times with the kids, and there was one particular one about the Civil War. And a general had been wounded severely, and he was taken care of by, he was a Southerner, by a Northern gal who couldn't stand slavery and hated the South and everything about it. And he thanked her for her excellent care and said, "You're so good at what you do." And she made some flip comment over her shoulder, and he called her by name and said, "You can't stop me from being grateful." Isn't that a powerful statement? Last week we read at the end of the message, nothing can separate us from the love of God. And if that's true, is that still true this week, or was that just true last week? If it's still true today, nothing can stop us from being grateful, because nothing has separated us from God's love this week. It's a choice. It's a spiritual discipline. I talked last week about how negative is so common, and it's contagious in a negative way, and it velcros and it weighs us down, and that we need to condemn not negative people, but the negative within them. We need to call it what it is, because it doesn't look good on others and it doesn't look good on us. And you know, I just want to say, I love living in a small community, because I feel people's eyes on me all the time. And I think they may or may not know that I'm pastor of the Nazarene Church, but hopefully they know more than anything that I want to be a follower, a faithful follower of Jesus. But I love the small communities because we're accountable. And you know, what's the big deal if Dixie and I go out to a restaurant and we really tip somebody well that just takes great care of us? How should we handle somebody that doesn't serve us well? Who might have the greater need? The greater need might be out of the one who is really struggling because of something that you know not of, and we're ready to judge them and the inconvenience to us. Come on, this is where we live. Somebody say, "Yes, Pastor, that's right." We need to reflect Jesus in crunch time. The Bible says, what big deal is it if you love those who love you? I mean, that's not exactly difficult, is it? It's when they don't. It's when the Lord wants us to minister and respond in grace with a loving heart, even what, not in kind. That's when God's Spirit can work more powerfully. I just threw that in for free. But I may have said it, but I'll say it again. As pastor here, I want to tell you what I struggle with. Many times, I have to be careful about getting an attitude about attitudes of others. Do you ever struggle with that? In other words, Jeremy can have a bad attitude, but my bad attitude about Jeremy's bad attitude can be almost worse than his bad attitude. I feel lonely up here today. I'm just spilling my guts, and you're going, "Boy, I didn't know that." I do. I don't want to be negative about people's negative. Do you? There isn't a person in here that doesn't love the vivid greens almost August. And you just got to love mowing your yard twice a week in August. Only in Ohio. We love the vivid greens. Man, you drive, Dixie and I were driving out to the city, just beautiful. How do you know that it takes rain? All sunshine is drought, right? It's true. I'm going somewhere with this. Because when I think about the Ohio weather, I think about life and how it happens in seasons. And I want to say today that a great goal for all of us is to develop a continual development process, a heart of gratitude-filled living. That becomes a spiritual discipline, if you will. It becomes a life discipline. I mean, we're going to have to be accountable to God and man. I mean, have you taken any inventory since last week? Did you ask anybody? Do I come across as negative sometime, or do we hear that and just go right back to the negative cesspool? I don't want to be a hearer only, do you? I don't want to just hear the word. I want to do the word. I want to ask the Holy Spirit to show me, prompt me. Lord, just don't tell my wife, because I don't want to be corrected through her. But anybody else, just kidding. Or husband. A spiritual discipline. Is gratitude a spiritual discipline in your life? How can we be filled with God's word and prayer and intimate in Him, but not be a grateful person, a gratitude-filled person? Does that go together? Grateful. I believe in doing this for quite a few years, that gratitude unlocks and opens doors for so many other good things. Positive qualities like sure, thankful, encouraging, generous, whatever, that's what enables us to do that living transformed peace. Contagious living, let's call it. My premise is this: you and I can always be grateful. And no one can stop us. All the powers of hell can't stop us from being grateful. Can you be grateful this way without being grateful this way? I think you can maybe be grateful this way without being grateful this way, but I know you can't do it this way and not be this way. What goes vertical must go horizontal. So, our Bible story. One of my favorite things was when I was a liaison between the church and daycare and school in Indianapolis, and I was the chaplain of the school, and I did chapel on Fridays for the whole squirming mass of humanity, 200 kids that were just like amoebas, you know, like worms in a jar. And the older kids sat in the back and trying to hold the kindergarten's attention all the way through sixth grade. And you know what I found the answer was? To dive into the Word and tell stories about the people that God loved. And this was probably one that I told, the 10 lepers. Does that sound familiar? So let's just look for a lesson. I'm going to pull out three lessons. They're not the only lessons for sure, but there's three of them that I want to land on today. But these are lessons in gratitude and the lack of it, okay? Have you ever learned a lesson by seeing the lack of something? Not just the example. So we're seeing the positive and the negative in this passage. So I want to go to Luke 17, and I want to read verse 11 here. As Jesus continued on towards Jerusalem, he reached the border between Galilee and Samaria. As he entered the village there, 10 lepers stood at a distance. How do you know distance is always a problem? They stood at a distance crying out, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Now, they couldn't help it that they were at a distance. They had that disadvantage. They had to be. But sometimes we stand at a distance and he says, come here. Come near. Distance is a problem, spiritually speaking. And if you do some digging on leprosy and a description of it, you go to Leviticus 13, you read about it, but you know that lepers had to let themselves go in every way, beyond their open sores and their missing fingers or whatever, because of nerves that were dead and couldn't, no feeling of pain. I mean, their clothes were torn. They were absolutely filthy, wild hair. I mean, they were a mess, and they had to keep their distance, and they had to forewarn people and say, unclean, unclean. You talk about isolated people. They were isolated. Thank you, honey. I appreciate that. She's my cheerleader. Seriously. How many of you know that isolation is never good? It's never good. Have you thought about this? Talk about an inferiority complex. Talk about rejection issues. Talk about low self-worth. I mean, they basically had no human contact outside and let alone intimacy. And Jesus just decided to do something about it. And I don't think he held his nose and said unclean. He called them near. He dealt with them directly as he was ought to do. I remember a story of Mother Teresa. I don't remember the exact how it goes, but she was training young nuns in India where she was serving the poor, and somebody came in and they had an open sore and it was infected, and it was awful, and they were trying to clean it up, and she pushed them aside and said, no, honey, this is how you do it. And she bent down and put her face to the sore and began to gently cleanse that wound. Can't you see Jesus? I mean, Jesus wants to do something about it. He wants to do something about our isolation and brokenness, just like he did here. Let me read on. Verse 14. He looked at them and said, we could talk about this. I think read and reread a passage. Go and show yourself to the priest. He didn't say, tell them anything. He said, just go and show. And as they went. Say, as they went. They were cleansed of leprosy. How many of you know that wonderful things happen when we move out in obedience when God says, go and show? How many things never happened and we're blaming him and we're mad at him, but it's because we've never obeyed his first command. Go and show. Be on the way. And on that journey, how many good things do we miss? I wonder. Wow. Cleansed of their leprosy, one of them, verse 15, when he saw that he was healed, came back to Jesus shouting, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." He wrote the doxology. I just made that up. He fell to the ground at Jesus' feet, thanking him for what he had done. And this man was a Samaritan. Read about that. Google that. You know, as I think about it, I would say that the nine just kind of reacted. Hey, I'm out of here. Hop, skip, got to tell Uncle whoever, an aunt, and my mom and dad. But the one chose a response. He came back and said, "I think it's time to worship." He fell to the ground, I'll read again, at Jesus' feet, thanking him for what he had done. This man was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Didn't I heal 10 men? Where are the nine? Didn't I save 10? Where are the nine? Haven't I provided? Haven't I made a way? Where are the nine?" I want to tell you, there's a whole lot more of us on the nine side than the one side. Yeah? I don't mean here, I just mean in the world. Where are the nine? All 10 were miraculously touched and transformed. Agreed? That's what the scripture said. They were healed. And I don't know that their leprosy came back because they didn't come back. But as they obeyed Jesus' command to go and show, they were healed. And that Samaritan of all people who shouldn't have known better, he came back with gratitude because Jesus had given his life back to him. Look at me. If we are in Christ, if we've come to him in faith, and if we've received, if we've been to the cross, answered the call, said, "Nathan, here, I come, I receive, I repent, I receive what Jesus has done on my behalf." He gave us our life back. Should we ever get over that? Huh? What are we focusing on? He's given us our life back, and that's eternal. That's unbelievable. So that's why I'm not going to go circumstantial. I'm going to go eternal. He's given me my life back. I can't thank him enough. I can't worship him enough. I think I'll spend eternity in heaven worshiping him because he gave me my life back. And the good news today, if you haven't received your life back, if you haven't been born twice from our second coming series so that you only die once, you need to take that step today. When you're born from the womb and born in Christ, saved, you only die once. Powerful truth. Here's a thought. Think about it, would you? I know you need to write it down. I have time to think about this ahead of time, so write it down and think about it, pray about it through the week. I just wonder. I'm not saying, I'm just wondering if a lack of gratitude keeps us from receiving good things from God sometimes. I think it squelches things if I don't have joy and gratitude for Joel for the good things that God's doing in his life. I think if I don't rejoice with him, I think that diminishes God's ability to bless me. And if I am not thinking, okay, I know he's God and we're not, but how do you like to give gifts to people that are entitled or don't appreciate it or are totally ungrateful? Well, we do it for him, first of all, right? We don't do it for people. We do it for him. Are you with me? Who do we do it for? Him. As Max Lucado once wrote, we're doing it for the applause of heaven. I mean, there were a lot of things I'd do as a kid. If I was in the yard playing or working or mowing and I felt my dad's eyes on me, man, I wanted to do it even better. That wasn't bad. That was a good thing. That was encouragement to me. 10 lepers. So I want to ask you again in the context where I started today, I wonder if sometimes our bad attitude about God and thinking he's not loving and all that, I wonder if we're experiencing some things we're experiencing because we're not people of gratitude. And that creates distance between us and God. Look at me. When we are not filled with gratitude for God's goodness who he is, that creates distance in our relationship with him. I don't know about you, but I don't want distance in my relationship with him. I don't want distance with my wife and with my kids and grand. I don't want distance, do you? So I'm saying today, on the authority of God's word, by his power and in us, not because we're so strong, but when we are weak, he is strong. His strength can be shown, his goodness can be shown through the likes of us when we are filled with gratitude in the most unlikely places and spaces. It blows people away. Have I said this lately? Because this isn't all there is. Let's live like it. We grieve, but we don't despair. We have hope. Because this isn't all there is. Oh, man. Have you chosen gratitude? And I'm just going to give you three quick points as I get ready to wrap it up. Statements, declarations, if you will. Okay. We sang about it today. Did you absorb the words of the last song they sang right before the message today? What I'll sing on the mountain, I'll sing in the valley, that God is always good. My first point is simple. The Bible says, not my feelings, the Bible says, every good thing comes from God. Which thing? Which things? And there's some things that come from God that we don't think are good, and we're missing out because they really are, because they're conforming us to the image of Jesus. Just because we don't see good doesn't mean God isn't up to good. Every good thing comes from God. I don't plan on spending my week thinking about the negative things. I'm going to think about the good things that come from God. I want to tell you, I'm way different at the end of the week if I think about that instead of looking for negative. One of my life verses for many years has been James 1:17, where it says very plainly, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. That's good news. Good news. Every good thing, is your heart open to this? Is your mind open to this that comes down in our lives is from God? Oh, yes, we may be good stewards of the gift that he's given. We may work hard, but the gift originates with God. You didn't come in with anything, and you're not going to leave with anything. It's all from God, and it's all for good. He's the one that gave us the ability. Could I ask you another question? And I want you to think about it, and I hope you'll respond and make note of this. Who is the most gratitude-filled person that you can think of that you know, and how have they impacted your life in a positive way? Who is the most gratitude-filled person that you know, that you've met? I don't mean that you've just read about. How has that impacted your life? Okay, you can fill in the blank. I'm sure you can come up with somebody, if not immediately over time. I wonder if anybody could write your name down. Would that be okay? Just being a gratitude-filled person, do you know how that can turn on the lights in a very dark room? Do you know how that can make so many significant changes? Gratitude. I want you to respond to that at some point. God is completely good, constantly good, unalterably good. He will never be not good. He's never less than good. God only does good. Could we embrace that attitude and that heart of gratefulness and see what happens over time? Well, Pastor, I tried it until bedtime and it just didn't work. I tried it for a week. Well, you've been negative for 50 years. Give it some time. You've been unthankful for so long. What's it called? You're rigor mortis and ungratefulness. petrified. The second thing is, be gratitude-filled now. Please say now. Why in the world do we fall for it? We think we'll be filled with gratitude then when we don't have gratitude now. It doesn't work that way. We'll only have gratitude there if we have gratitude here. Look at the language of God's word. It's now. Now. What will it take for you to turn your heart toward gratitude? I don't know. Here's something I see, if you can follow me. Don't allow the desires and the ever-bending road of life before you and the ups and downs of the journey, don't allow those desires and dreams not yet realized to kill your gratitude now, or you may never get there. I don't know about you, but when I get ready for vacation and family vacation, I enjoy the journey. As soon as we pull out of our driveway, I just... I used to get so hepped up about us leaving an hour or two later than I originally said that I lost my joy in the journey. I go, that's stupid. I know none of you have ever done that, but I did. We're supposed to enjoy the journey, and the only way we can enjoy the journey from here to heaven is to be filled with gratitude all the time, running over, splashing out contagiously on others, getting them all wet with gratitude. I would say that a heart of gratitude turns what we have into enough contentment. And in essence, we're saying, I don't have everything, and I may have dreams and aspirations, but I just want to tell you, I want to go on record, Jesus is enough. He is the below the freeze line foundation of my life. Nothing else is needed. He is enough. I can't make that decision for you. I have to make that decision for me. I, in recent weeks, gave the illustration of the person in South America, remember the family that were so overwhelmed with the reality of heaven and they were so filled with joy in the middle of abject poverty because Jesus is enough. Philippians 4:11, he says, not that I was ever in need because I have learned to be content with whatever I have. That's gratitude language, by the way. Verse 12, I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I have learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little. 13, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. That's gratitude. That's expectation. You see, it's not what we really need, it's who we really need. It's not what you need that's going to put you there, it's who you need, and that's Jesus. And if he's in your life, gratitude is in your life. Even if it seems to be dormant. Finally, make sure that every blessing is turned to praise. Because you know what happens if it's not? If a blessing from God is not, because he's the giver of everything good, is not turned to praise, you know what will happen? Pride will kick in. You're not that good, and I'm not that good, and we're not that good, but he is great. He is good. And it's not our goodness that's going to change the world. It's his goodness in relationship within us. That's what's going to radiate power and love. That's what's going to make an impact in our neighborhoods and in our working relationships at school. All the time. Not just when you're in a good mood. God's still good even when I'm grouchy. And I think I need to be grouchy less because I don't have much to be grouchy about. Oh, I'll find a reason sometimes. Some of you are going to want to go to another church. That pastor's messed up. Yep. This is a pretty good hospital right here we have. I've been told from time to time, oh, pastor, do you know so-and-so's at church and don't know what happened this week? Can you think of a better place for them to be today? It's in a country club. My friend Andre said, we're having church. Psalm 63:4, I will praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer. You satisfy me more than the richest feast. I will praise you with songs of joy. Lord, you've made this day. You've created it. You want me to rejoice and be glad into it. And that sounds like gratitude to me. And that's what I'm going to be about today. Amen? I'm not going to do a wind check. It's gifted. I'm to face this day with gratitude. Because I know it's settled, God is good. That's an intimate act of worship, if you will, and that's what I call pointing and praising. That's what our lives are to do. That's going and showing stuff language right there. Well, I need to wrap it up. Could I just ask you to do another thing in your mind and heart? And we talked about salvation for sure, but put yourself in the leper's spot and think of something in this life and think about life being lost and destined to be nothing but the way it is. And then you encountered someone who, not through your own goodness or your efforts, nothing you could do, he just gave you your life back. Would your life ever be the same? Then go and live it. Go and live it. You can't talk me out of the song, God is always good. He was good when our marriage fell apart. He was good when my mother died in a car accident. He was still good. That's why I can recommend him to you. That's why I can call you to make a decision to open your heart to him. To let go of the bitterness. And that was the one thing takeaway from the Second Coming series, saying at the great white throne judgment, remember, let it go, because there's nothing that's not under the blood that God will not deal with. So you don't have to carry it. You don't have to deal with it. Just let go and just be filled with God's goodness. He's got it covered. And maybe the best thing I said last week in passing was this: what's under the blood stays under the blood. And that's not a gory thing. It's a powerful thing. Oh, man, I could counter it. Oh, my house is always in chaos. Praise God, be filled with gratitude for the blessing of children and grand. Be thankful for headlights and taillights. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I don't necessarily, this isn't a life or job, but Lord, I'm so thankful for one, for the provision. My house is really too small, but we don't have to heat it as much or cool it as much or clean it as much. This church is too big. Isn't it exciting? It means more people headed to heaven. It's not just about me or a few of us. Psalm 103, let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things, say good things, he does for me. He forgives all my sins. He heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things. My youth is renewed like eagles. And so I will say, praise the Lord, I tell myself, first thing in the morning, last thing at night. Let's not go circumstantial anymore. Let's be the children of God. Let's let our identity be this. I am a child of God, and that changes everything. That's who I am. It's not about who I am. It's about whose I am. I am a child of the Most High God. Talk about the sun rising. That's the dawn of a new life. God fills my life with good things. I will not wait. I will not be late in thanking him, of being grateful for all of his gifts, praising him for who he is. I want to respond in this way. I am one who has been forgiven much, and so I will love much. I will praise much. I will thank much. I will give all my heart and life to him, nothing held back. I will praise him as long as he gives me breath. How about you? Would you mind, if you can, if you care to, would you stand with me? Thanks for being so attentive and responsive. You make it easy to preach. Everything good comes from God. Number one, be full of gratitude right now. Turn every blessing into a praise. Look for the activity of God. I mentioned it, but have any of you ever experienced that too? You're praying intensely and God's Spirit kind of taps you on the shoulder and goes, you're the answer to your prayer. If you change your attitude, if you allow me to change you, I might work this, turn this whole situation right set up. Have anybody ever had that experience besides me? I mean, I was praying about my wife and he said it's my fault, for goodness sake. Oh, that just ticks me off. Then I have to get out of the shower and dry off and dress and go apologize and, oh, man. I think if your God isn't good, you're spelling it the wrong way. Mine is capital G, capital O, capital D, the I am. Yours is small g, small o, small d. And that's no different than the gods of this world. But I'm serving God who said, I am. Good? Okay. If we don't decide to choose gratitude ahead of time and have this wheel of steel to stick to it, when the heat's on, we'll have a meltdown. I don't want to have a meltdown, do you? Well, I don't know what you're going to sing. I'm going to pray. But number one, if you need an attitude transformation, just give God you, because if he's got all of you, he's got the attitude. Do you know what I'm saying by that? We get so fixated on a thing. I want to give God a thing. He doesn't want a thing. He wants you. And what a powerful testimony, because people know you're going through some stuff, but you are filled with gratitude. And they go, unbelievable. It's got to be God. It can't be you. You're not that good. But he is. Can you tell this is one of my favorite topics? I have not arrived. I'm on a journey, but it begins with giving Jesus your sin. If you're carrying a boatload of unforgiven sin today, you don't have to go out of here with it. It can go under the blood today, but you've got to confess and repent and turn from your sin and self to him. That's the first step in having an attitude recreated, being full of gratitude. Have you taken that step? I'm going to give you an opportunity in a moment. No matter who you are, no matter how lowly, high, and mighty, that's what it takes. But maybe today, you just need to pray and say, Lord, I need you to show me. I think maybe I'm filled with gratitude, but what's it looking like to the people that I want to? Are they getting stereo? Do they not know which side of the mouth I'm talking or living out of life? And we need to confess it. We need to forsake it. We need to turn our back, and we need to turn toward God. So whatever. But first of all, I want to pray, and I want you to pray out loud after me. Dear Jesus, pray, just everybody in the house, would you? Dear Jesus, thank you for your amazing love. Thank you for forgiving my sin. I confess. I repent. I'm sorry. I turn toward you. I will live for you. I can't change me, but you can. So I give you my sin. I give you myself. I surrender. I want a relationship with you. I choose it. And I choose an attitude that is full of thankfulness and gratitude. Thank you, Jesus, for doing in me what I could not do myself. Would you just begin to sing, Father, thank you again. Thank you again for receptivity. I pray that this message won't just fall on ears and roll off us like Teflon and roll off, but we'll put it into practice beginning today, right now, that we'd be obedient to your word, your beckon, your call, and say, yes, Lord, I need an adjustment. I need some attention here. I don't want to reflect you in a negative way. I want to be so full of gratitude that people will see you and they'll point in praise. Not point at me, but point to you. So Lord, in the closing moments, could people just respond to what you're doing in their hearts? I can't mandate it. I can just do my best to present what I feel I should, but it's your Holy Spirit that prompts us to take action. Thank you for your faithfulness. We're going to open the altars as they sang. You know by now that we have designated spots. You can pray alone on the stairs. These altars, the end altars, are for healing prayer. If there's something specifically you want to be prayed for God's healing touch, physically, emotionally. But I just wonder if there's anybody that wants to pray about this. Just bow your heads one more time. I just need to check this out too. Bow your heads before we go. Anybody say with me, Pastor, I really prayed that prayer today and I meant it about inviting my heart, Jesus, into my heart and life. I want you to raise it. Yep, I see one. I'll put it down. Yeah, thank you. Others? Yep, I see another one. Come on, who else? This is significant. We're talking about changed life. Yeah. Who else? I prayed that prayer. I meant it from my heart. It wasn't just a lip thing. It was a heart thing. Who else? Anybody else? Yeah. Yeah, I see that too. God bless you. We're going to sing. Would you just sing a little bit? We're in good shape for time. And if you want to come pray. And by the way, I'm writing an article for some magazine about the altars, the importance of them in our church and all that. And I just love the altars. And I can't think of a better way to end a service than just to use them. My prayer is that in first and second worship, that we'll just make a habit out of just swarming the altars when God's close and talking to us. So I just want to invite you to come. You can come and bow for anything. It doesn't have to be message specific. But yet, if God's prompting you, would you step out and just spend some quiet moments praying with him about whatever's going on in your heart and life? Maybe a heart of praise and thanksgiving for new life in Christ. Sing it, would you please? And we're going to hold steady. Sing along if you know it. Anybody just want to step out and say, I'm going to spend some time praying. It's okay to ask somebody to come with you. Would you pray with me? It's okay. Whenever I call, Lord. Thank you. Come on. Just respond to God's Spirit. He's here today powerfully. He's calling you. Come on, respond to his call. He's for you, not against you. Surrender to his love and goodness. Lord, give me a heart and eye examination. Change my prescription so I can see clearly your activity, your goodness, your grace. Any others? Don't miss the moment. Don't live in the circumstance. I'm settling it. Some of you just need to settle the issue of God's goodness. Some of you need to repent for your attitude toward God. You've missed it. He's good. Anybody else? This is a song we're going to sing. Bless you. Change our hearts, Lord. Change our homes, our marriages, our relationships, our families with the power of your love. People of gratitude who represent you very well, who carry your name in a believable way to a world that is watching. Neighborhoods, family, friends, work. My praise will shout for joy. Thank you, Lord. The plan stands firm forever. Anybody else in the house today? Boy, don't push his voice away. Don't be distant when he's calling you. It gets easier to get more distant. Respond when he speaks, would you? You want to? Yes, Lord. I'm going to turn that blessing to praise. I'm going to praise you now in the storm. I'm going to be grateful now. I recognize you're the gift giver. For you. I will bless you, Lord. I will bless you.
You, Lord, I will bless your holy name. You, Lord. How my soul cries out. For you, my God, I will bless you, Lord.
If you're here and made a decision for Christ today, I would love to look you in the eye and congratulate you. Our welcome area, we have materials there to help you in your journey. I can't emphasize enough the My Start class. It's basics of faith. We're filling in our grow track with wonderful things that'll help you grow spiritually. Please, let's put a priority on it. If we're going to grow, it's going to be because of intentionality. We choose it. But there's materials there in that welcome area in the foyer. You can stop. But let's take our times. This is a place of prayer. You can still get in on it, the prayer time, if you need to. You can always be seated or stay where you are and pray. That's fine. But would you just take your time and greet each other and be super warm? Let's just hang out together a little bit. Could we do that? Could we do that? God is so faithful. Thank you, Lord. Don't forget our Outlinks box. Let's bless New Destiny Mission. Over 60 men in an extensive...